Hello friends, we are going to today learn basic concept of valuation in finance. See, you want to value anything in finance, it is done by one particular concept that we are going to learn in this first basic concept of valuation. But let us first understand how accountancy values. Say I want to purchase one share of Reliance and it is available at rupees of 1000 today. If I purchase this share today, what will be the cost is 1000 rupees. Accountancy will pass journal entry Reliance share account debit to cash at 1000 rupees. So accountancy values everything at cost. See the use of accountancy. After 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, if I want to know what was cost of my Reliance, I can easily open my books of accounts and find out that cost of Reliance was 1000. On other hand, in finance, the purpose is different. But first, let me tell you how anything is valued in finance, and then I will tell you why it is valued in such a manner. In finance, everything is valued by present value of its future expected cash flows. Now, this valuation technique we'll be using for valuing the share, valuing a small pin in finance, valuing an aeroplane in finance, valuing in a company in finance, anything in finance is valued by this particular concept. We have already learned the chapter of time value of money. We know how to find out present value. You just need to forecast future cash flows. Once you forecast future cash flows, find out the present value at your own required rate of return. It will be your valuation of finance. See, my required rate of return is 10%. I feel that this Reliance shares, after 1 year, if I purchase it today, I get dividend at the end of 1 year. Dividend is my cash inflow. At the end of 1 year, it will be giving me 100 rupees a dividend per share. I'm planning to purchase one share. So I will be getting exactly rupees 100. This is as dividend. And after 1 year, I'm going to sell the share. Now I'll have to forecast what will be price of this share after 1 year. By some method I have derived, and understand it is forecast. Once it is a forecast, there is no 100% guarantee that this will be the price. But the price of the share, this is price after 1 year of Reliance, price of this share is going to be 1010 rupees. So I will be getting 100 rupees dividend, 10 rupees as capital gain, as I have purchased, might have purchased at 1000 rupees, and I will be selling it at 1010. Now, what will be total cash flow after 1 year is 1110 rupees. If I had purchased this share, Now understand how Reliance will be valued in finance as far as I am concerned, because this is my required rate of return. This will be only my valuation. How I will be valuing? You will say, sir, first quarter, what about second year cash flows? Now I am expecting, I am assuming that I am going to sell it at the end of first year. At the end of second year, there will be no cash flows. There will be nothing regarding cash flows at the end of second year. So, the Reliance shares, if I had purchased at the end of first year, I will be getting a cash flow of 1110. Now, understand the valuation technique in finance. It is present value of a future cash flow. This is my future cash flow. At the end of 1 year, my cash flow is 1110. If I want to find out present value, we have done it in the chapter of time value of money. If I want to find out present value of this, it is A into 1 divided by 1 plus I raised to N. 1 plus I will be 0.10 raised to N is raised to 1. So what will be my valuation is 1 divided by 1.1. multiplied by 1110 is 1009 rupees 0.9. This is my valuation of Reliance done as per financial technique. Now, why it is done and what is this? Is this a market price of Reliance? No, market price of Reliance is 1000. This price is 1009 rupees 0.09. What is this? Understand, this is my valuation of Reliance. Valuation, but it is my valuation of Reliance. In other words, this is a maximum price I am ready to pay for Reliance. This is a maximum price I am ready to pay for Reliance. And now understand why in finance we value by this method. Finance is a decision-making subject. Before purchasing this Reliance, I will be making a decision whether to purchase this Reliance or not. Now understand, what is the maximum price I am ready to pay for this Reliance is my valuation or maximum price is 1009.09. What is the market price? What is the price at which I can purchase it is 1000 rupees. Maximum price I am ready to pay for Reliance is 109.09. Market price is 1000. Market has undervalued. If market has undervalued something, I should purchase it. Now, this decision I will be taking before purchasing Reliance shares. Before purchasing Reliance shares, what is my decision? Whether to purchase Reliance or not. For that, I need to decide whether the market has overvalued or undervalued. Reliance, market has overvalued. I will purchase the Reliance. This price, how it has helped? This price has helped me to take this decision. Understand, whether it is overvalued or undervalued, you need a good valuation. This is my valuation of Reliance. Maximum price I am ready to pay for this Reliance. It is available as 1000 rupees. What is my decision? This decision is based upon this figure. I have compared this figure with this figure. This decision is based upon this figure. Finance helps you in decision making. Understand, once you have purchased this Reliance, whether Reliance is giving me 100 rupees, 200 rupees, 500 rupees as a dividend is not concerned of this particular subject. My consideration was whether to purchase this Reliance or not. This price will help me to take this decision. So in finance, now you need to keep this particular thing in your mind without forgetting. It is a present value of future cash flows. Thank you, friends. Hello, friends. This is question number C1.1.1. See the question. Current dividend D0 is 2.5. Discount rate is 10.5%. Growth rate is 2%. Calculate the present value of stock of ABC Limited. This is my first question. Calculate present value of growth of ABC Limited. I will be using value at the end of 0 year, cash flow of first year divided by rate of return minus G. This is how I find out present value, and to find out valuation in finance, it is present value of future cash flow. Cash flow of first year will be 2.5 rupees plus a 2% growth rate, because this is D0, I need to find out cash flow of first year. Divided by rate of return is 10.5 minus 2%. So 2.5 plus 2%. comes to 2.55 divided by 8.5%. So 2.55 divided by 8.5% comes to rupees 30. See with what they are asking in second question. Is it stocks overvalued if the stock price is 35. What is the market price? Is rupees 35. And they just want our answer whether it is overvalued or undervalued. Return on equity is 9%. This is written in second question. Return on equity is 9%. And earning per share is 2.25. Now understand, value of equity, if say it is per share, multiplied by return on equity, I get answer of EPS. Very logical. What is the market price of the equity? Multiplied by return on equity or book value of equity multiplied by return on equity, I'll be getting earning per share. Actually, it is book value of the equity into return on equity is EPS per share. Here what is given is 2.25. This is also per share. Return on equity is 9%. I can get book value of equity per share because this is per share, and book value per share will be 2.25 divided by 9%. It is 2.25 divided by 9% is rupees 25. So what is the question asked? Is the stock overvalued? Understand, we should never consider book value of the stock. We should always consider overprice of the share, compare it with market price. What is the overvaluation of share is? 30. This is a maximum price I am ready to pay, 30. What market has valued it? 35. So market has overvalued. It has overvalued even if you compare it with 25. It should be compared with 30, but even if you compare it with 30, 25, it is overvalued. 30 also it is overvalued. Thank you, friends. Hello, friends. This is class work 1.1.2. A company has a book value per share of 137.80. So it is book value. 137.80. So how this would have been done is all net asset minus liabilities. There is total assets minus liabilities will be net assets divided by number of shares. This is price per share. Its return on equity is 15%. And follows a policy of retaining 60% of its annual earnings. So retain earning ratio is 60%. If the opportunity cost of capital is 18%, so cost of capital K is 18%. What is the price of its equity shares? What is the price of its equity shares? So let us first find out earnings per share. Now how to do it? It is book value per share multiplied by return on equity. Book value per share is 137.80 multiplied by 15%. 137.80 multiplied by 15% is 20.67. This is earning per share. Now you'll say me, sir, how this is earning per share and how this book value per share 137.80, it is not value of equity. If it is value of equity multiplied by return on equity, I might get earnings per share. Understand, book value is nothing but equity. Try to understand this concept. This is your balance sheet. What is book value of the company? Value of all assets minus value of all liability. Say this is 10, this is 90, this is 100. This is equity, this is liability, this is asset. Now, how the value of the book value of the firm will be found out? 100 minus 90, which is nothing but equal to value of equity. So, if it is a book value of equity multiplied by return on equity will be nothing but earnings of the company. It is book value per share. That is nothing but equity value per share or face value of equity per share multiplied by return on equity will be nothing but earning per share. As this book value is per share, earning will be per share. Now the company has a retention ratio of 60%. So DP0, dividend per share of 0 year will be 20.67 multiplied by 40%. How I have found out 40%? If the retention ratio is 60%, then dividend payout ratio will be 100% minus 60% is nothing but 40%. So 20.67 multiplied by 40% will be nothing but 8.268. Alright. Now, growth is not directly given in this question. Can I find out retention ratio or can I find out the growth rate in this question? The answer is yes. Understand the Gordon's model in dividend policy. How we used to find out growth rate is B into R. What was B is retention ratio. Retention ratio is 60%. What is the return on equity is 15%. My retention will earn 15%. So I'll be having a growth of this. So it is 60 into 15 percentage will be nothing but 9%. So my growth rate will be 9%. I will be finding out value of this particular share. How to find out value of this particular share is nothing but it is given return on equity. So this might be taken as EPS 0. As in suggested, it is assumed as EPS 1. I am assuming this as EPS and EPS 1. Understand, you can also assume this as earnings of 0 year and not earnings of first year. But we want to match the answer, we have taken EPS 1. Now understand, valuation of share is very, very easy. How we find out valuation of share is present value of future cash flows. So what will be my cash flow? At the end of first year, it will be 8.268. At the end of second year, third year, infinite with a growth rate of 9%. We have done how to find out present value of infinite cash flow with growth is cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. Cash flow of first year is 8.268 divided by rate of interest. My opportunity cost, my required rate of return, minimum required rate of return is 18% minus growth rate of 9% is 8.268 divided by 9%. So it is 8.268 divided by 0.09 will be giving me 91.86 rupees. It is rupees and 91.86. This is the valuation of the share or maximum price I am ready to pay for this particular share. Thank you, friends. Question number is 1.1.3. So what does the question say? MNP has declared and paid annual dividend of rupees 4 per share. Already paid annual dividend of rupees 4 per share. Now sometimes you might be having confusion whether this is B0 or B1. Understand, if it is already paid, we will not be taking it as B0. It is expected to grow at the rate of 20%. So growth rate is 20%. For the next 2 years. So let me draw. at the end of first year, cash flow is my dividend. What will be my dividend is 4 plus 20% is 4.8. It is expected to grow at 20% for next 2 years. This is only for 2 years. And 10% thereafter. So, first, second, third, fourth, fifth will go up till infinite, will go up till infinite. In second and third year, it will switch. The required rate of return on equity investor is 15%. Compute the current price at which the share should sell. We need to find out valuation of the share. How to value the share is nothing but present value of future cash flows. Now, first we need to find out cash flows, then I'll be finding out present value for the same. So, in second year, the growth rate will be 20%. So, what will be cash flow or dividend in second year is 4.8 plus 20%. It is 4.8 plus 20%, it is 5.76. What will be dividend in third year is 5.76 plus 20%. No, the growth rate of 20% is only for 2 years. So in third year, it will be plus 10%. So 5.76 plus 10% will give me 6.336. Now, up till infinite, it will be having growth rate of 10%. It will be having growth rate of 10%. So, what you should do in your examination, try to understand. For this 2 years, when the growth rate is 20%, I will be finding out the present value separately. How to find out present value of first 2 years is very simple. It's divided by 1.15. Rate is 15%. Raised to 1 divided by 1.15 raised to 2. For this 2, I will be finding out present value together. Let me find out. It is 1 divided by 1.15 multiplied by 4.8. I am getting 4.1739. I am adding it into memory. 1 divided by 1.15 is equal to. I am getting this answer multiplied by 5.76. I am getting this answer. I am adding it into memory. MRC is 8.5293. It is approximately 8.5. Now, this is present values. Understand, this is value at the end of 0 year. Because I have discounted this for 1 year, this for 2 years. This present value I will be finding out separately. Now, how to find out present value of infinite cash flow with growth is present value at the end of 0 year will be nothing but, see, I'm changing some of the things in which the presentation is made. I'm writing out, so value at the end of zero, present value at the end of 0 year or amount at the end of 0 year is same. What is the formula? Amount at the end of 0 year is cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. Is it correct? Now, we are not starting with first year. We are starting with third year. So, I am changing this formula. If this is 1 and this is 0, if this becomes 3, this will become 2. If this was 1, this was 0, I have made it 3 and 2. So, cash flow of third year is 6.336. Divided by rate of interest 50% minus growth rate 10% is nothing but 6.336 divided by 0.05 or 5% is 126.72. Add this to, no, This is value at the end of a second year. As we started with third year, this is value at the end of second year. We cannot add value at the end of 0 year and value at the end of second year. So understand what I'll do. I'll convert this value at the end of 2 years into value at the end of 0 year. How? Very simple. I'll discount it by 2 more years. Discounting it by 2 more years is 1 divided by 1.15 is 2. So it is 1 divided by 1.15 is equal to. It is 1 divided by 1.15 is equal to, gives me this answer, multiplied by 126.72. It is 95.81. is nothing but value at the end of 0 year. Value of 2 years, I have discounted it by 2 years, I will be getting value at the end of 0 year. This is value at the end of 0 year. This is value at the end of 0 year. So 8.53 plus 95.81 plus 8.53 gives me answer of 104.34 approximately. This is nothing but value of the share in this particular. Thank you, friends. This is class 4. 1.1.5. So, what does the question say? Question says ABC Limited has maintained a growth rate of 10% in dividend. The company has paid a dividend of rupees 3 per share. Now, whenever this given company has paid a dividend of rupees, I will be taking it as a B0 and it is rupees per share. The rate of return on market portfolio is 12%. So, RM is equal to 12%. And the risk-free rate of return in the market is observed at 8%. So, RF is 8%. The beta coefficient of the company shares is 1.5. So, beta is 1.5. You are required to calculate the expected rate of return of the company shares as per CABM model and equilibrium price per share by dividend growth model. So, we will be applying the concept of CABM. We are already in the video for the same of CAPM. What does CAPM say is your required rate of return for valuing anything KE, or your required rate of return is nothing but RF plus beta into RM minus RM. This is risk free rate of return, this is risk premium. This RM minus RF is market risk premium. What is RF? Is 8%, beta is 1.5, RM minus RF is 12% minus 8%. So it is 8% plus 1.5 into 4%. So 1.5 into 4 is 6, 8% plus 6% will be is equal to 14. So, required rate of return as per CAPM model is 14%. We are also going to find out the value of the share. How to value anything in finance is a present value of future cash flow. Now, as what will be the price after second year, third year is not given, we will be taking that we are going to earn a D1. Say at the end of first year, what dividend will be earning? Rupees 3 plus 10% is nothing but 3.3. Second year, third year, up till infinite point of time with a growth rate of 10%. How to find out the present value of this all future cash flows? present value of infinite cash flow with growth, present value that is at the end of 0 year will be is equal to cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus J. So this concept we have learned in time value of money. For logical understanding, you can go to time value of money and understand how this formula came. Cash flow for first year will be 3.3. Rate of interest, required rate of return for me is 15%. Minus G is 10%, will be nothing but 3.3 divided by 2%. You can do it in your calculator in two manner. You can either press 3.3 divided by 0.04, or you can press 3.3 divided by 4%. It is 3.3 divided by 0.04 is 82.3. That's nothing bad. This was classwork 1.1. Thank you, friends. Hello, friends. This is question number C. 1.1.5. This is C. 1.1.5. Let us understand what does the question say. Mr. E is thinking buying of shares at the rate of rupees 500. So market price of share is rupees 500, having face value of rupees 100 each. So face value per share is rupees 100. He is expecting a bonus in 1:5 during fourth year. So bonus 1:5 will be in fourth year. Annual expected dividend is 20%. So dividend rate is 20%. And the same rate is expected to be maintained on expanded capital base. This will be learned. He intends to sell the shares at the end of 7th year. So selling price at the end of 7th year at an expected price of rupees 900 each. So expected price is rupees. Incidental expenses for purchase and sales are to be 5% of market price. So expenses related to purchase and sale is 5%. He expects a minimum rate of return of 12%. His required rate of return is 12% for an investment. Should Mr. A buy the share? If so, what maximum price should he pay for each share? Assume no taxation, dividend income and capital gain. So this is the information given in the question. The question also asks us whether we should purchase this share or not, or maximum price we are ready to pay for this particular share. Understand, in finance we value anything by present value of future cash flows. So let us understand future cash flows. Future in this case will be for 7 years. Right, because he'll be purchasing share today, selling at the end of 7th year. So he'll generate a cash flow for the period of 7th year. So what will be cash flow in first year? See, bonus is issued in 4th year. So in first year, you will be having a dividend at the rate of 20%. Whenever it is a dividend ratio, it is always on face value. So what will be the first year's dividend? Will be face value into 20%. I'm assuming I'll be purchasing one share. One share is having face value of 100, dividend 20% is 20 rupees. So for first 3 years, I will be having dividend of 20 rupees. For first 3 years, in fourth year, I am getting bonus. So at the beginning of fourth year, if I am having 5 shares, I will be getting 1 share. How many shares I am purchasing, or I have assumed that I have purchased this one share. So if I am having one share, how many share I will be getting? I will be getting 1:1 divided by 5. That is 0.20 share. Sir, how the company will issue me 0.2 share? They cannot issue fraction of shares. Understand, but here we have taken an assumption we are purchasing one share. Suppose we are purchasing 100 shares. Then we will be getting 20 shares as dividend. So for the purpose of calculation, we can take 0.20 shares. So how many shares now I am having? At the beginning of fourth year, how many shares I am having? One I was already having, 0.2 I have got as bonus. So I am having 1.2 shares, having face value of 100. So my total face value is 120. Dividend 20% will be issued on expanded capital base. This is expanded capital base. So I will be getting 24 rupees a dividend now onwards. So in fourth year, I'll be getting 24, fifth year 24, sixth year 24. I am selling at the end of seventh year. So on in seventh year also, I'm getting 24 rupees as a dividend. Now understand, at the end of seventh year, I will be selling this share. At what rate I'll be selling? 900 rupees. But now understand, I have purchased one share initially. At the end of 0 year, I have purchased one share. But now, I am not having one share. I am having 1.20 share. I will be selling it at the rate of rupees 900. Selling at the rate of rupees 900 will give me 1.2 multiplied by 900 is 1080 rupees. Also, whenever I sell the shares, 5% on selling price expenses will be incurred. So minus 5%, 1080 minus 5% will give me 1026 rupees. So what will be my selling price at the end of 7th year? I have purchased one share, got bonus at 0.20 rate. I will be selling all including bonus 1.20 shares at the rate of rupees 900. I will be getting 1080, out of which 5% I will be expending. So I will be getting 1026 rupees. 1026 rupees. So 1026 plus 24 will give me 1050. It is 1050 rupees in 7th year. It's correct. Now it is very simple. Present value of future cash flows. I have got future cash flows. I will be finding out present value at the rate of 12%. So present value at the rate of 12%, it is good to divide this in three different classes. This will be into 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 1, 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 2, 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 3, 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 4, 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 5, 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 6, 1 divided by 1.12 raised to 7. Concentrate if you are not knowing what I am doing in my calculator. 1 divided by 1.12 is equal to m plus, is equal to m plus, is equal to m plus. This 3, I have put it into memory. MRC, 20 I have taken as common, so multiplied by 20, I am getting 48.03. Value at the end of 0 year, because I have found out present value. This is interesting. See how I am doing, I am taking 24 common, this I will be putting in memory. 1.12, 1 divided by 1.12 is raised to 1, is equal to is raised to 2, is equal to is raised to 3. See, I am not putting this in memory. Now, is equal to is raised to 4, m plus, raised to 5, m plus, is equal to m plus. So, this 3 I have put it in memory. 24 was taken as common, MRC multiplied by 24, I am getting 41.02 value at the end of 0 here. Last one, 1 divided by 1.12. Raised to 7 is equal to 7 times, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, multiplied by 1050 is 474.96, 474. This is also I have found out present value, so it is value at the end of 0 year. In finance, if all the values are at the end of 0 year, I can just add it, plus 41.02 plus 48.03. I will be getting answer of 564.01. As we have learned in basic concept, this is a maximum price. This is my valuation of the share, or this is a maximum price I am ready to pay. Now understand at what rate the share is available. What is the market price? What is the price at which I can purchase this share? Is 500 rupees, but I'll have to pay 5% as an additional expenditure. So it is 500 plus 5% is nothing but 525 rupees. Now understand. Maximum price I am ready to pay for the share, getting 12% rate of return, is 564.01. In market, it is available at 525. So market has undervalued. I am getting this share at cheaper cost as per my valuation. So as the share is undervalued, and whenever anything is undervalued, what you will do? You will always purchase. So what is the decision, whether you will purchase the share or not? Answer is yes, you will purchase the share. And second question is, what is the maximum price you are ready to pay for the share? Is 564.01. This was question number C, 1.1.5. Thank you. Hello friends, this is question number 1.1.6. It is C, 1.1.6. See the question. Saranam Limited has issued convertible debentures with a coupon rate of 12%. So what is the coupon rate? Is 12%. Each debenture has an option to convert to 20 equity shares. So it can be converted into 20 equity shares. At any time until the date of maturity, debenture will be redeemed at rupees 100 on maturity of 5 years. So if you continue with debentures, how many years cash flow you will be getting is 5 years. An investor generally requires a rate of return of 8%. So your required rate of return is 8%. As an investor, when will you exercise conversion for the given market price of equity shares 4, 5 and 6? Alright, so first understand, we will be finding out the value of debenture today. What should be the value, or what is the maximum price I am ready to pay for this debenture today? Is it alright? So, 12% coupon rate, it will be redeemed at rupees 100. So, at the end of 5th year, I will be getting rupees 100 back. Face value is not given. I am assuming 100. So, it is weird to assume 10 rupees, because the redemption value is 100, face value will be 100. What will be the coupon I will be getting every year? Is the face value multiplied by coupon rate is 12 rupees per annum. So every year 12 rupees, and in last year I will be getting 12 rupees plus redemption value. Let me find out present value of this figure at the rate of 8%, because my required rate of return is 8%. So first, let me find out value of this rupees 12 for first 4 years. 1 divided by 1.08 is equal to m plus is equal to m plus is equal to m plus is equal to m plus. 4 years, MRC multiplied by 12. So this is value of first 4 years. Will be is equal to 39.70. 5th year, 1 divided by 1.08, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, raised to 5, multiplied by 112 is 76.22. 76.22 plus 39.74. is 115.96. This is value of debenture as on today. It is value of debenture as on today. Is it all right? So if someone says me whether I should purchase debentures or not, I need a market price of debenture. I'll compare it with my maximum or the maximum price I am ready to pay for the debenture and then decide whether to purchase the debenture or not. But here the question is different. For one debenture, you can convert it into 20 shares at any point of time. So what is the value of debenture today? Is 115.96. If I convert this into equity shares today, how many equity shares I will be getting? 20 equity shares. Now they have given three options. If the price of equity share is 4, I will be getting value of 80 rupees. Now value of 115.96, that is value of debenture, is higher than value of equity share. So I should not convert. Whether I will convert, my decision is I will not convert. In second case, it is 5 rupees. Again, value of debenture is higher, value of equity share is lower. I will not be converting it into equity shares. Last is 6. Understand, this is our option. Either the price is 4, either the price is 5, or the price is 6. Here, I will be getting 120 rupees. Now, the value of debenture is 115.96. Value of equity share is 120. 120 is higher. So, if equity shares are worth rupees 6 today, then I should convert it into equity shares, continue with equity shares. If equity shares are of rupees 4 or 5, I should not convert it into equity shares, continue with debentures. Thank you, friends. First question number C, 1.1.7. Let us first read the question. X Limited just declared the dividend of rupees 14%, just declared the dividend, so I'll assuming it as D0. Mr. B is planning to purchase the share of X Limited, anticipating increase in growth rate from 8% to 9%, which will continue for 3 years. So for finding out valuation of any security, we find out first cash flows, end of first, second and third year. And this person anticipates that growth rate will be 9%. It was 8%, but now it will be converted into 9%. He also expects that the market price of this share to be rupees 360 after 3 years. So what will be the market price after 3 years is 360. So we'll be assuming that he is selling the shares after 3 years and getting this. You are required to determine the maximum amount Mr. B should pay if his required rate of return is 13%. So ROR is 13%. Maximum amount is required to pay, or in other words, valuation of security. Maximum price I am ready to pay for this share is one and the same. How to find out the answer is present value of future cash flows. So what will be the dividend for first year? Dividend for 0 year is 14 rupees plus 9%. So dividend for first year will be 14 rupees plus 9%. 14 rupees plus 9% is 15.26. 15.26 plus 9% is 16.63. 360 will remain 364. We will be discounting this present value at the rate of 13%. So what I'll do, I'll multiply it by 1 divided by 1.13 raised to 1, 1 divided by 1.13 raised to 2, 1 divided by 1.13 raised to 3. I can directly do it in memory. 1 divided by 1.13 is equal to multiplied by 15.26 is equal to M plus 1 divided by 1.13 is equal to is raised to 2 multiplied by 16.63 is equal to M plus. So this is added in memory. 1 divided by 1.13, 3 times is equal to, multiplied by 360 is equal to m plus mrc will be giving me answer is 276.02. 276.02. This is a maximum price I am ready to pay for this particular. Okay, what we have missed out is this. I am selling at the end of third year, so I will be getting dividend at the end of third year. Alright, so dividend at the end of third year will be 16.63 plus 9%. Agree? So 16.63 plus 9% is 18.126. So now I am rectifying the answer. Actually, this 2 should be added and then I need to find out present value. But as I have forgotten this, I can directly now find out the present value of this and add it in my answer. It is 1 divided by 1.13, 1 divided by 1.13 is equal to, so 3 times is equal to, multiplied by 18.126, multiplied by 18.126 will give me answer of 12.56. So I have rectified my answer, I have forgotten my dividend, found out present value and added in the answer. 12.56 plus 276.02. It is 288.58. So this is a maximum price I am ready to pay for this particular share. Understand, here in third year I have forgotten the dividend. I have taken it separately, found out the present value, added in my answer, I have got the answer. It is 288.58. Second question. The maximum price Mr. B will be willing to pay for the share if he is of the opinion that 9% growth can be maintained indefinitely and required 13% rate of return per annum. So this becomes my question number 1. I will be solving question number 2. If my first year cash flow is 15.26, second year, third year goes up till infinite with a growth rate of 9%. Again, I need to find out present value. Present value of infinite cash flow with growth is nothing but cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. Cash flow of first year is 15.26 divided by 13 minus 9% is 4%. So 15.26 divided by 4% is 381.5. This is my second answer. Let us go to third one. The price of the share at the end of 3 years, if 9% of growth rate is achieved and other conditions remaining same as above, price at the end of third year if the growth rate is 9% and is achieved and assuming other conditions remaining same as in 2. Understand, what does question number 3 say? So, they say you need to find out value today. No, value at the end of third year. Value at the end of third year. Now understand, if I want to find out value today, what I did was, I did cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. So this formula is very simple. Value at the end of third year is cash flow at the end of fourth year. If I take 1, I get 0. If I take 4, I get 3. Cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. Now it says that rate of interest minus G should be taken as in question number 2. So denominator will be 4%. What is cash flow of a fourth year? What is cash flow of a fourth year? What is cash flow of third year? Is six cash flow of third year? Yes, is 16.63. Plus 9%. So cash flow of third year is 18.126. So cash flow of fourth year will be 18.126 plus 9%. So 18.126 plus 9% gives me 8.857. This gives me 8.857. divided by 4% gives me 221.43. Oh, I'm making some mistake. 18.126 plus 9%. 18.126 plus 9% gives me 19.75. 19.75 divided by 4% gives me 493.90. Understand, this is not valuation as on today. A weird question is asked. What is asked is, what will be valuation at the end of third year? So this is a different type of question, whereby they are telling us to forecast what will be value at the end of third year. And value at the end of third year will be 493.93. Understand, this figure cannot be compared with price as on today. This is just forecasting. If this assumption remains true, what will be value at the end of third year? Thank you, friends. Hello friends, this is question number C, 1.1.8. Let us first read the question. Sams Limited has just paid a dividend of rupees 2 per share. Has just paid means it is D0, 2 per share. And it is expected to grow at 6%. So growth rate is 6%. After paying dividend, the board declares to take up a project by retaining the next 3 annual dividends. So what is proposed? That in first, second and third year, no dividend will be paid. It is expected that this project is of same risk as the existing project. The result of this project will start coming from fourth year onwards from now. So in proposed situation, the cash flow will start from fourth year. The dividend will then be 2.5 per share. So at the end of fourth year, dividend will be 2.50 if the situation is taken into consideration, and will grow at 7%. So in that case, the growth rate will be 7%. The investor has 1000 shares in SAM Limited and wants a receipt of at least 2000 per annum from this investment. So what is the requirement for the investor is, he wants minimum rupees 2000 and he will be owning 1000 shares. Required, evaluate whether the market value of the share is affected by the decision of the both. So whether the market value is affected or not, we need to take two market value. One is the current market value, or what should be the current market value, and what should be the proposed market value. So in current situation, if the company does not take up this particular project, what will be the market value? Again, I will be finding out by the same concept, present value of future cash flows. Is it all right? Here, I will be taking D1, dividend of second year, will go up till infinite period of time. D1 will be 2 plus 6%. Is nothing but 3.2, will go up till infinite with a growth rate of 6%. So how to find out? We have already considered this in time value of money. How to find out? The answer is the present value at the end of 0 year is nothing but cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. Cash flow of first year will be 3.2 divided by rate of interest. So required rate of return should be given somewhere. It is given after second point. Recommended how the investor can maintain its target reserve for the cost of investment and improved income thereafter, given the cost of capital is 8%. So my minimum required rate of return is 8%. So rate of interest is 8% minus growth rate is 6%. So, if this proposed situation is not taken into consideration, it will be 3.2 divided by 2%, which is nothing but rupees 160. So, without declaring this proposed plan, the company's market value of the share should be rupees 160. If this proposed situation is taken into consideration, understand what will happen. At the end of first, second and third year, nothing will be declared. In fourth year, dividend of 2.5 rupees will be declared, which will grow up till infinite at a growth rate of 7%. So what will be value at the end of third year? Understand, I am using the same formula. Value at the end of first year gives me present value at the end of 0 year. Value at the end of third year is nothing but dividend of fourth year divided by rate of interest minus G. What is dividend of fourth year is 2.50. Rate of interest is 8% minus, now the growth rate is 7%. So it is 2.5 divided by 1%. Is nothing but rupees 250. So what should be the market price of this proposed situation is not declared is 160. If this situation is declared by the company, then the market price will be 250. So this decision of not to declare the dividend, retaining it in the project, will increase the market price. It should be 160 without declaring the proposed plan, and it will be 250 after declaring the proposed plan. So in case of first question, evaluate whether the market value of share is affected. Answer number one is, the answer is yes, market value of shares will be affected by this particular decision. Recommend how the investor can maintain his target receipt. Now what is the target receipt of investor is minimum rupees 2000. For the first 3 years and improve the income thereafter. So, what I'll be doing is, I'm knowing value of the share after 3 years in this case. In first question also, this is value at the end of third year. We need to find out value at the end of 0 year. So value at the end of 0 year will be 250 into 1 divided by 1.08 raised to 3. Understand, this is value at the end of third year. This is value at the end of 0 year. This cannot be compared. So we need to convert it into value at the end of 0 year. Value at the end of 0 year is 250. 1 divided by 1.08, 3 times is equal to, multiplied by 250 is 198.45. still my answer remains same, that value is effective. Understand, as the second question suggests me, I'll also find out value at the end of second year. What will be value at the end of second year? 250 is value at the end of third year. If I discount it one time, I will be getting value. Now this is value at the end of 0 year. This will be value at the end of second year. What will be value at the end of second year is 1 divided by 1.08 multiplied by 250 is 231. Value at the end of first year. So it will be 231, which is value at the end of second year. Again, discounted it by 1 year, I will be getting $212.96. So I'm having market price of the share at the end of 0 year, that is today. Market price of the share at the end of first year. Market price of the share at the end of second year. Now understand, this is not an actual market price. This is just a valuation done by us. That is valuation of security done by us. This should be the market price of the share. Comparing this with this figure, answer number one is yes. Whether the market price will be affected by the proposed decision, the answer is yes. Second question says, he wants his rate of return. What is his minimum rate of return is 200. Now, at the end of first year, what is the market price is 212.96. At the end of first year, market price is 212.96. How much money he wants is 2000. So 2000 divided by 212.96. Understand, in proposed situation, in first year, no dividend will be declared. So he will have to sell his shares. He is having 1000 shares. He will be selling how many shares is 2000 divided by 212.96, which is nothing but 9.39. Let me assume 10 shares. So he will be selling 10 shares at the rate of rupees 212.96, and he will be getting 2129.6 rupees from the share at the end of first year. He wants this per annum. At the end of second year, the market price will be 231. He requires 2000 rupees. So he is going to sell more shares, that is 2000 divided by 231 is 8.65. Let me assume 7 shares multiplied by 231. So he will be getting 231 multiplied by 7. It is 2000 divided by 231. Is 8.65. 2000 divided by 231 gives me 8.65. So it is 9 shares. 9 shares multiplied by 231 will give me 2079 rupees. So he is getting minimum 2000 rupees every year as he wants. In third year, the market price of the share at the end of third year is 250. He wants minimum 2000 rupees. So 2000 divided by 250, he will have to sell 8 shares multiplied by 250. So he will be exactly getting 2000 rupees. So in first 3 years, company has not declared any dividend. Still, he has got minimum 2000 rupees every year by selling 10 plus 9, 19 plus 8, 27 shares. So now how many shares he will be holding? He will be holding 1000 shares minus 27 shares, that is 963 shares. So at the beginning of fourth year, he is still holding 963 shares. he will be getting dividend of rupees 2.50 for every share. So in fourth year, he will be getting 963 shares multiplied by 2.50. 963 multiplied by 2.50. He will be getting 2407.5 rupees as dividend in fourth year, which will grow at the rate of 7% every year. So by having this 1000 shares, he can generate cash flow of 2000 rupees for first 3 years. Company will not be declaring dividend. He can generate the cash flow, all the cash flows, which will be greater than 2000. From fourth year, he will be getting dividend of 2407.5, which will grow at 7% every year. And this is how he will adjust his situation. Thank you, friends. This is question number C1.1.9. So what does the question say? The risk-free rate of return is 5%. The expected rate on the market portfolio is 11%. The expected rate of growth rate is 8%. The last dividend paid was 2. Last dividend paid. We have done this n number of times. If it is last dividend paid, we will be taking D0. The beta of the equity stock is 1.5. What is the present price of equity stock of X Limited? This is question number 1. What is price of equity stock? Let us find out first required rate of return by CAPM model. CAPM says that required rate of return will be RF plus beta into RM minus RF. Risk-free rate of return is 5% plus beta is 1.5. into RM minus RF is 6%. RM is 11. 11 minus 5 is 6%. This is 5% plus 9% is 14%. So my required rate of return is 14%. Is it all right? Let us find out by perpetual growth model, what is the value of a share? Infinite cash flow with growth, the cash flow of first year divided by rate of return minus G. What is cash flow for first year? Dividend for 0 year is 2 with a growth of 8%. So 2 plus 8% divided by rate of interest. We have found out 14% minus growth rate is 8%. 2 plus 8% is 3.6. Divided by 6%. So 3.6 divided by 6% is 60. So what is the valuation of share today? It is nothing but 60 rupees. Making a slight mistake. This is not 3.6. 2 plus 8% is 2.16 divided by 6%. 2.16 divided by 6% is rupees 36. Yes, now it's fine. This is nothing but valuation of share. Now, see the second question. How would the price change when the inflation premium increase by 3%? Now understand, inflation premium increase by 3% can be categorized into two ways. So my RF will become 5% plus 3% of 5%. 3% of 3%, 5% is, it is a 5 plus 3 percentage is 5.15. Alternate approach, my RF will be 5% plus directly 3% is 8%. There is nothing right or wrong, understand, it should be clearly given that inflation premium 3% is what? You can take 3% or 5%, or you can take this assumption. I am taking this assumption and will be calculating some as per this particular assumption. The expected growth rate decreases by 3%. So growth rate 1 now will become 5%. And the beta decreases to 1.3. This is question number 2. And understand, as nothing is given, I am not given that find out the price separately changing each variable. What I am doing is, if the question says all 3 points and we put AND in between, then the inflation premium increases by 3% and the growth rate decreases by 3% and beta decreases to 1.3. If all 3 happens together, what will be the price of the share? This will be our assumption. So let me write it down. What will be my now RF will be 8% as I am assuming this. Expected growth rate decreases by 3%. So G will be 8 minus 3% will be 5%. And beta decreases to 1.3. So beta will become 1.3. Beta will become 1.3. Is it all? Let me find out valuation of the share again by changing all the variables. Cash flow of first year divided by rate of interest minus G. But first I need to find out required rate of return by CAPM model will be RF plus beta into RM minus RF. By same method I am finding it out. But now RF is 8%, beta is 1.3, RM remains same 11% minus 8%. So it is 3%, 3, 11.9%. Is it alright? This is my required rate of return. So cash flow of first year is 2.16. No, this will also change. Why this will change? Here it is 2.16 with a growth rate of 8%. Now the growth rate will be 2 plus only 5%. Divided by rate of interest 11.9% minus G is 5%. So it will be 2.10 divided by 6.9%. So 2.1 divided by 6.9% will give me 30.43. If all this variable changes, the price of my share will be nothing but 30.43. This was question number C, 1.1.9. Thank you. Hello friends. This question is C, 1.1.10. Let us read the question. The hypothetical company ABC Limited issued 10% debentures. So they are 10% debentures having a face value of 1000. Face value is 1000 rupees. Of the duration of 10 years, number of year is 10 years, is currently trading at 850 per debenture. Price as on today is 850. The bond is convertible into 50 equity shares. They are convertible, this debentures or bonds are convertible into 50 equity shares, and the market price of the equity share right now is rupees 17 per share. Is that all right? So it is 850. Understand, right now it is at par. Whether you see the value of debentures or whether you see the value of equity shares, there is after conversion, what will be the value of my one debentures today is 850. So ultimately, whether it is debentures or equity shares, it is valued at rupees 850. If the yield on equivalent comparable bond is 11.80%. Now, what does this understand? Yield on comparable bonds is 11.80%. Then calculate a spread of yield. Now, how to find out spread of yield? Try to understand. I will be finding off yield of my bond. Difference between these two will be nothing but spread. To find out yield of my bond, yield is how much my bond is actually earning, how much rate of return my bond is actually earning. You need to go to concept of IRR. You've already learned in capital budgeting concept of IRR, what the bond is earning. Actually, I'll be finding out actual IRR of this project. How much cash flow it is giving me? 1000 into 10% will be rupees 100. Every year for the period of 10 years, so 1 to 10 years, the cash flow will be rupees 100. Cash flow will be rupees 100, and in 10th year, I will be getting my redemption value back, that is 1000 rupees. I am finding out present value. It's a 10%, no, say 11%. Comparable bond is, understand IRR can be found by always trial and error method. Present value of this cash flow, this is 1 to 10 years, every year 100 rupees. So it will be 1 divided by 1.1 is equal to 10 times grand total multiplied by 100. And that figure, what you will add, 1 divided by 1.11 is equal to 10 times multiplied by 10,000. That two figures will be added. I'll be getting present value at the rate of 11%. I'm directly taking it from the book. And it is coming positive 91. It's coming positive 91. And same for same cash flow. Present value at the rate of 13% is coming to negative 12.40. Now understand, at NPV 0, this is NPV. How to find out NPV? Present value of cash inflow minus present value of cash outflow. Cash outflow is 850. NPV here is 91. NPV here is minus 12.40. What is NPV 0? The project is exactly earning required rate of return. What is NPV positive 91 means? The project is earning more than 11%. What does NPV negative 12.40 means? The project is earning less than 13%. So the project is earning between 11 to 13% using interpolation technique. This is the first and last question where we are actually understanding logic of interpolation. Understand? Let us take 11% as base. This I am taking as base. What is my NPV is 91. At 13%, my NPV is negative 12.40. So what is difference in NPV? 91 minus 12.40. No, 91 minus minus 12.40. 91 plus 12.40. 40. That is 103.4. Is the difference? What is difference in NPV? 103.4. What is difference in rate? What is difference in rate? Is nothing but 2%. Let us take this 11% as a base. I cannot afford a plus 91. I want NPV 0. I want to exactly find out what amount of return the project is earning. So plus, how much rate? If I, what is the change in NPV is 103.4. How much I need to reduce it? 91. So if I increase the rate by 2%, my NPV will decrease by 103.4 rupees. If I want to decrease the NPV only by 91 rupees, how much rate should change? Are you getting it? Why I want to decrease only by 91 rupees? If I decrease by 91 rupees, NPV will be 0. At NPV 0, the project is earning exactly required rate of return. Is it all? So cross multiplying that is 91 divided by 103.4 multiplied by 2. So it is 91 multiplied by 2 divided by 103.4, which comes to 1.76. So 11% plus 1.76% is 12.76%. What is IRR? This is the rate at which NPV will be 0. If the rate NPV will be 0, means project is earning 0 rupees. No, project is earning required rate of return. At 12.76%, NPV will be 0. And so it is internal rate of return, the rate of return which project is earning. And the rate of return which bond is earning is nothing but 12.76. So what is the difference in yield? The difference in yield is 12.76 minus 11.8 is nothing but 0.96. So spread is 0.96%. Thank you, friends. Hello, friends. This is question number C1.1.11. It is C1.1.11. Let us first read the question and along with it, write down all the details which are available. Sewell Corporation, a manufacturer of do-it-yourself hardware and housewares, reported earning per share of pound of euro 2.1 in 2013. So let us consider 2013 and it is 2.10. So whether it is euro or rupees, it does not make difference. On which it paid dividend per share of 0.69. So what was dividend? This is earnings and this is dividend. And the dividend was 0.69. Earnings are expected to grow 15% from 2014 to 2018. During this period, the dividend payout ratio is expected to remain unchanged. So let us consider what is dividend payout ratio. Is 0.69 divided by 2.1. It is 32.85%. Dividend payout ratio is 32.85%. All right. After 2018, earning growth rate is expected to drop to a stable rate of 6%. So now it is after 2018. It is written 2008, actually it is 2018. So after 2018, that is from 2019 onwards, growth rate will be 6%. And the payout ratio is expected to increase to 65% of earnings. So, dividend payout ratio will be 65%. The firm has a beta of 1.40 currently and is expected to have beta of 1.10 after 2018. That is, your beta will be 1.10. And before 2018, it will be 1.40. So your beta will be 1.40. Let me write down dividend payout also on this side. This 32.80 dividend payout is 32.85. The market risk premium is 5.5%. RM is 5.5%. Is it RM? No. It is market risk premium. Understand? There is difference between market rate of return and market risk premium. What is market risk premium? RM minus RF. You can go to CAPM model video and understand this. Market risk premium is 5.5%. The treasury bond rate is 6.25. This is RF. 6.25%. What is the expected price of the stock at the end of 2018? So question number one is price of a stock at the end of 2018. Question number B. It is written as AMB. Question number B is, what is the value of the stock? Whenever you are said value of the stock, it is nothing but value. That's it all. So first, let's try out, say today is 2013. So I'll be ignoring this particular cash flows. I'll be starting with this cash flows, starting from 2014. Now, what is the growth rate from 2014 to 2018? Earnings are expected to grow at the rate of 15%. So, growth rate is 15%. Let me first find out earnings. Earnings is 2.10 plus 15% is 2.415. What I have done? 2.10 plus 15%. Plus 15% is 2.78. Plus 15% is 3.19. Plus 15%, 3.67. Plus 15% is 4.22. This is 4.22. Plus 4.22. Plus, now the growth rate is 6%. So, plus 6% will be 4.48 approximately. So, from 2019, it will be 4.48, will grow up till infinite with a growth rate of 6%. Now understand, even beta value changes between 2014 and 2018 and after 2019. So let us find out required rate of return, which will be applicable to 2014 to 2018 and 2019 onwards. So what is CAPM model? RF. RF is 6.25. How to find out required rate of return? RF plus beta into RM minus RF. So RF 6.25 plus beta. What is beta over here is 1.40 into RM minus RF is 5.5. So 5.5 plus, sorry, multiplied by 1.4 plus 6.25 will give me answer of 13.95%. 2019 onwards, it is RF 6.25 plus beta. Now the beta value changes, it is 1.1 into RM minus RF is 5.5. So this answer will be 5.5 into 1.1 multiplied by 6.25%. It is 5.5 multiplied by 1.1 plus 6.25 is nothing but 12.3%. All right. Now, all the data required, rate of return, cash flow, everything is available. Let us solve one by one both the question. A. Price of the stock at the end of 2018. Now understand, if we consider right now it is end of 2018, then what may be cash flow for first year? If I consider today as end of 2018, cash flow of first year will be of 2019. Infinite cash flow with growth model, required rate of return minus G will be value at the end of 2018. Is it all right? We have understood this. Cash flow of first year divided by rate of return minus G gives value of 0 year. So cash flow of 2019 will give value of 2018. So what is cash flow of 2019 is 4.48 divided by rate of return. Now I need to take rate of return onwards from 2019 is nothing but 12.3% minus growth rate of this unlimited will be 6%. So it is 4.48 divided by 6.3%, which will be is equal to 4.48 divided by 6.3% will be is equal to rupees 71.1. What is the problem is, we have taken cash flow as earnings, and in this question even dividend is given. We need to even find out dividend. Dividend rate remains same. If the rate remains same, understand what is the rate of dividend? 32.85%. So 2.415 multiplied by 32.85% understand will be same as this cash flow is increasing. This cash flow is increasing by 15%. If this is increasing by 15%, the percentage remains same. This is also increasing by 15%. So it is 0.69 plus 15%, it is 0.794. This will be 0.794. Similarly, it will be 0.913. You can do 2.78 multiplied by 32.85% or 0.794 plus 15%. 1.048, 1.206, 1.387. Now wait a minute. Now don't do 6%. Why? Now the dividend payout ratio is changing. Now the dividend payout ratio is 65%. So in 2019, what will be issued as dividend is 4.48 multiplied by 65% will be 2.91. So this figure will be 2.91. This will now grow at the rate of 6% that we can take. All right. Now, what mistake we had made? We had taken earnings. Actually, it is not a mistake. It is valuation based upon earnings. Normally, the valuation should be based upon dividend. So, let me take dividend over here. It is cash flow of 2019. What is cash flow of 2019 is 2.912. It is 2.912. So, even this figure will be 2.912 divided by 6.3% will give me answer of 46.22. I could have found out valuation based upon earnings, but understand what is the problem. Valuation based upon earnings, as dividend is given, it is better to find out valuation based upon dividends. Is it all right? So, this is valuation at the end of 2018. Now, if someone tells me, find out valuation today. See what I'll do. This is valuation at the end of 2018. These are my cash flows for first of 5 years, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So, these are cash flows of first 5 years. This is valuation as on 2018. See what I'll assume. I am purchasing share today, will be earning dividend for 5 years. After that, I will be selling at 46.22. So, in 2018, what value I will be getting is 46.22. Plus 1.387 is a 47.61. So now in 2019, you will not be getting now anything in 2019, because what you are assuming, you take this dividend, sell it in 2018, at the end of 2018 at 46.22, because we have already valued the share at 2018, and what cash flow will be getting is 47.61 at the end of 2019. Is it all? Now, this all cash flows can be discounted. This 5, I'm selling it in 2018, can be discounted at a rate of return between 2014 to 2018, that is 13.95. So, this is 1 divided by 1.1395 raised to 1. 1 divided by 1.1395 raised to 2, 1 divided by 1.1395 raised to 3, 1 divided by 1.1395 raised to 4, and 1 divided by 1.1395 raised to 5. And If you value this, if you find out the present value of all this answer. Now, I have directly taken it, so I am not practically calculating it, but you can do it in this manner. 1 divided by 1.1395 multiplied by 0.794 is equal to m plus. 1 divided by 1.1395 is equal to multiplied by 0.913 is equal to m plus. Similarly, over here also m plus. You will be getting present value of all the cash flows. And the present value of all the cash flows is 27.58. It is 27.58. It is actually euro, not rupees. This is nothing but valuation as on share 27.58. Thank you, friends. Hello, friends. This is question number C, 1.1.12. Subnav Limited has issued convertible debentures with coupon rate 11%. So, what is coupon rate is? 11%. Each debenture has an option to convert to 16 equity shares. So, convertible equity shares is 16. At any time until the date of maturity, debentures will be redeemed at 100 rupees on maturity after 5 years. So, debentures will give me cash flow for 5 years, and after 5 years, it will be redeemed at the rate of rupees 100. And investors generally requires a rate of return of 8%. So required rate of return of investor is 8%. As an advisor, will you advise the investor to exercise conversion for the given market price of the equity shares? So what is the market price of equity shares? They have given three options, 5, 6, 7.10, 5 or 6 or 7.10. Cumulative present value factor is given, but normally I do it in my calculator. So whether to convert this debenture into shares or not, first we need to find out what is the real value, what is my valuation, what is the value, what should be the value of the debentures. How I'll be finding out by same manner is the present value of this cash flows. What will be cash flows? Very easy. What is the face value and rate? Assume multiplied by 11% is 11 rupees every year. So for first 5 years, I will be getting 11 rupees every year as coupon, and 100 rupees I will be getting redemption value. So this will be 111. What is my required rate of return is 8%. So I'll discount this at the rate of 8%. Even this at the rate of 8%, I'll be getting the answer. Now I can easily do it. It is 1 divided by 1.08. Is equal to m plus, is equal to m plus, is equal to m plus, is equal to m plus. So 4 times m plus is done, MRC multiplied by 11 I have taken at common. So 36.43. How to find out present value of this is 1 divided by 1.08 is equal to 5 times multiplied by 100 and is 75.50. If I total this out, it is 36.43 plus 75.54 will give me answer of 111.97. So the book answer and our answer is somewhat different, just because of we have taken present value in our calculator. They have taken directly present value normally of two or three digits, that is 3 digits. Right. Now let us see the convert. What is the value of the debenture as on today? 111.97. So if my conversion value of all equity shares, how many number of equity shares I am getting? 60. If I convert it at rupees 5, I will be getting 80 rupees. If I convert it at rupees 6, I will be getting 96 rupees. If I will be converting at 7.10, I will be getting 113.60. See, understand, these are all or situations. The market price of equity shares cannot be 5, 6 and 7.10. It will be either 5 or 6 or 7.10. So, if the price is 5, I am having an equity value of 80. If I convert all the one debentures into all equity shares, that is 16 equity shares, my debenture value is 119.97. I will not be converting it into this case into equity shares. I will keep debenture as it is. In this case also, value of debenture is higher. I will not be converting it into equity shares. In this case, value of equity share is higher. If the market price is 7.10 of equity shares, I would advise this particular person to convert it into equity shares. In first two cases, I will not advise him to convert it into equity shares. Thank you, friends.